Senator, we have you on the air. Good morning.
Oh, good morning. You were on the air, and I was still talking to Weatherford.
Well, that's all right. We appreciate hearing what you're doing. How are
it
you?
It sounds like Jay Douglas. Is that right?
Yes, and Matt Stocking is here with me this morning.
How you doing, Matt? Good.
Great. Good to have you, Senator.
Thank you.
Can we just dive right in? Have you read the memo?
I've not read the memo.
So we can't.
Are you talking about the memo on the?
The memo that written by the House of Representatives.
Oh, no. Let me clarify that. When you said the memo, okay. There are two memos going on right now. One was, of course, the memo on the new defense policy. On the other one, I went over to the House of Representatives. It's their intelligence department who has it, and they will not release it even to another member. They will not release it to any member of the Senate. Now, they should, but they didn't. So the answer is no, I don't have that. But I do have access to what we're doing militarily.
Well, let me back up, though. This memo is supposedly quite damaging to the Attorney General and to the FBI. Is that how you understand it or what you hear
Hold
about
on,
it?
Hold on just a minute.
I think he's getting
that, oh, okay, that was okay, that memo, there's two of them, as I say. That one reflected during the Obama era, FBI in some detail, and the answer is no, I do not have that.
Okay. Well, my question is that kind of supersedes any other scandal? I mean, are we going to...
Well, Russian collusion or any of that. I mean, other stuff that we've been being force-fed over the last several months, well, really since Trump goes into office. So this is very damning towards what the Obama and Hillary administration was putting out there.
See, I went over there, Jay Douglas, and I know this is, I probably shouldn't even say this on the radio, but I'm going to do it. I went over to the Intelligence Committee on the other side of the Capitol to the House of Representatives. That was yesterday. They came out and they said they can't share that with me. Now, all I know is just what you said. Something is allegedly very, very damaging. And I wanted to see it, and I told them I would not release anything they show me, but I wanted to know for myself. They have not yet released that. So
who sets up this procedure?
Oh,
the House Intelligence Committee writes a memo, and then they put something on it that says you can read it, but you can't discuss it. And then it goes to the president, and he gets to read it.
Okay, the only ones who can read it are the ones that are on the Intelligence Committee at the House. Now, if we really press it, we might be able to read it but not say anything about it if you're on the Intelligence Committee of the Senate. Now, I used to be on it. I'm not anymore. And I think you know why, because we found that most of the things that you get on the Intel Committee are things that you read about in the Washington Post the next morning, but then you can't talk about it when I'm talking to Jay Douglas or somebody back in Oklahoma.
Right.
So it's wrong, but nonetheless, I went over, all the way over there to try to get it and to satisfy myself, and we'll know soon, we just don't know now.
Would you explain to our listeners how exactly, why you've been in the Senate for a number of years, how or why Congress came up with this procedure of getting a warrant to supposedly ferret out people who are committing treason against this country so that they go before 11 judges or one judge and he allows the wiretapping and a search of certain officials they claim they think may be endangering the United States of America. What is all that? How's that FIFA warrant? Why did that take place and why is it needed? Do you have an answer to that?
Yeah, you know, I really don't. I'm sorry, Jay Douglas. I'm not sure. I know about the FISA system, but I don't know who is entitled to it. The big issue with the FISA is always, are you able to get things from other countries you can't otherwise get? And there are a lot of people out there that say, no, we don't want the invasion of privacy. And that, of course, that's an ongoing issue. But to answer your specific question, can't do it.
Okay, well, now you mentioned another memo that I'm not familiar with.
Well,
Tell me about that.
The memo, the current defense strategy that they have, the National Defense Strategy. It's one that is published each. It's supposed to be published every 3 or 4 years, but it has to be published, I believe, every 10 years. It just came out, and the concept is, and by the way, if any of your listeners who are interested in just the military, I'll be on C-SPAN at 9 o'clock Sunday morning for 30 minutes just talking about the military. So they might be interested in that to get more details. The defense strategy is a 2+3 concept, and that is that China and Russia are the peer threats. They're the threats that are there that, and according to our new policy. And then the other three, 2+3, the three are North Korea, Iran, and ISIS. Now, they talk about how they're looking at lethality. Just for example, there are some countries that have a better artillery than we do. And I'm talking about China, both China and Russia, and some of our allies, like Germany. This all happened during the 8 years of Obama. And we do know that after November the 28th, that North Korea now has a range that can hit, Woodward, Oklahoma. And we are fully aware of that now. And I have to say one thing about the president. I know everyone's critical of him, Jay Douglas. They all talk about the words that he uses and all that. But when Kim Jong-un came out after the November 28th, demonstration that they can range United States of America. He came and said, I have a button now, I can push this and I can wipe out a city in America. And our response was, our president's response was, yeah, but we have a button, it's a bigger button, we have better technology, you try that and we'll wipe you off the map. What happened after that? The very next day, North Korea notified South Korea that they were going to participate in their Winter Olympics, that they were going to boycott before, and they're now working together, actually communicating. I'm not saying that had to be the reason for that to take place. So now we're looking at our defense posture and our strategy. We have a nuclear posture review. Since the end of the Cold War, Russia and China have made huge investments in their nuclear arsenal, you know, the triad that we've talked about in the past, and we have not done anything, and we're going to start doing that now. So that's the new defense strategy. As I say, I'll get into a lot more detail on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock if anyone's interested.
Well, I'm not a strategist and by no means a military strategist, but I don't understand why we simply don't bomb all of those sites that they use, those missile sites in North Korea, so he doesn't have any projection to get those over. What's the story there?
Well, first of all, if we thought we had the location for certain of every place where they had the capability of deploying a nuclear weapon, yes, that would be a good idea. But if you don't know that, and we don't, our intelligence is good, but that's a moving target. So we don't know. Keep in mind, we just like our THAAD system over here, you can move it around. And so you don't know you could hit those. And if they have something, what we don't know is where they have that capability and how many different places. So you don't want to go in there and do that. And then, of course, if that starts, you got to keep in mind that we have 27,000 people over there. And so it's, if we had the knowledge, the answer would be that's why we do it.
Speaking of bending of will, I guess recently we had the government shutdown. Now, Democrats were, I guess, not being very cooperative, and so that was the reason for the shutdown. But all of a sudden, they kind of sway a little bit and say, well, okay, we'll go ahead and we'll allow the government to open back up here for a few weeks. I guess the question that I had was, what was it that changed their mind got them to maybe back up?
I can tell you exactly what it was. And first of all, I've been through every government shutdown since 1987. This is the first shutdown that we've had where there can't be any doubt as to who caused the shutdown, because it was in one vote that it took place. Now, in that vote to shut down government, 95% of the Democrats voted to shut it down. 95% of the Republicans voted not to shut it down. So the public caught up, and the reason that was given by the Democrats for shutting it down is the DACA issue. Sure, we all have compassion for the kids and all that, but these are people who came here not on their own doing, their parents and so forth. You know the issue. But nonetheless, the people out there who are compassionate for these kids are saying, yeah, we're compassionate, but not if you're holding our military hostage to get this done. And all of a sudden, the polling changed, and Chuck Schumer had no choice but to go ahead and go along with this. Now, right after that happened, his very liberal base, the liberal side, the most liberal side of the Democrats out there, were outraged that he caved in. And now he had to make some statements after that. Well, we're going to make these demands. I can assure you, I'm not personally involved in that negotiation on the demands on DACA, but I'm absolutely convinced that it's going to work. Because,
well, do you trust the numbers? I mean, these people are not young kids anymore. A lot of them are in their 30s and 40s.
People are aware of that. Yeah.
The numbers are correct.
Well, I don't know. They are not. That's why there is a difference of opinion between Democrats and Republicans. And they now have found that in terms of how serious the issue is, it may be serious, and I'm talking about Democrats now, it may be serious, but it's not so serious that that we can hold our military hostage. And that's what's happened. Now, you ask about the National Defense Strategy. They all know what that strategy is. One of the differences, and I want to remind people who are critical of this notion that defending America in many cases is partisan, because the policy that we had during the Obama years was that we're not going to put any more money, sequestration, into the military unless we put an equal amount into our social non-defense programs. Now, that's not what the Constitution says. That's not what we've always done in this country. Just as an example, up through the late 60s, we spent over 50% of all of our revenue on defending America. Do you know what it is today? It's 15%. And that kind of gives you an idea of what has happened to the deterioration of us while other countries are putting in, they are advancing. I mentioned the nuclear posture review that we're going through right now. Russia and China have increased substantially their nuclear arsenals that we haven't since the Cold War. So we are now, I think, in a position to give a higher priority, and the people that were on their side of the shutdown are saying, yeah, we're compassionate, but not to the extent that we're going to hold the military hostage for it. So that's what's happening now. I want to mention one thing that it gives you a chance out there. It's very important. I was there in Woodward, as you know. I was out there three times in my plane during the horrible wildfires that were going on. And so we have introduced and have the votes to pass and have the bipartisan support for the bill that I introduced along with a Democrat from New Mexico. And that's the Wildlife Regulatory Relief Act. Do you want me to just, I can real quickly just say what it is,
sure,
so that people would be
aware. Hear about it.
Yeah. It allows, first of all, the CRP lands. That's a conservation reserve program that we have, and it's been on the books for a long time. And it restricts who can graze, what farmers can have their cattle graze on that land. And that was one of the problems that we had when this thing first happened. Now we're saying that in the case of a declared disaster by the governor of the state, then they can use the CRP lands to graze their cattle. Because keep in mind, and I remember flying over just a little bit north and actually west of you and watching, you know, cattle being burned alive and all of this. And, of course, their fields are gone. And they had a lot of compassionate people that sent a lot of, you know, hay in and feed and all that. But nonetheless, the CRP element is significant. The second thing is, under FEMA, the only thing that the farmers can get really compensated for is their residence. And you look at the fence rows, it costs, what, $10,000 a mile to repair a fence row through one of these wildfires. So they've included fence rows and other elements other than just the home itself. The third thing, and this is important because all of the banks out there want to help people at this, excuse me, at the time of a crisis, but they can't do it because of the regulations that are over-regulating the bankers. And you ask any banker who's out there listening to us right now, and they'll tell you that they wanted to do more for these farmers, but they're restricted by some of the regulations that have come through in previous years, and that's going to cause that to change. But This does give them an exemption from existing regulations when they come to help people during these disaster times. Those are three things. It's big, and it's going to help.
Well, what legislation is up there to change this? Because banks are going to say our hands are tied.
No, they're not. That's my legislation. Okay. Everything I said on this, these three things will be written into law to allow them to do that and exempt them from some of the overregulation. Dodd-Frank, for example, is the overreg. You talk to anyone in the lending and the financial institutions, and they'll tell you that's been an absolute disaster. And this
well,
will be.
Where is your legislation now?
Oh, it's introduced. It's in. We're gathering co-sponsors right now. We have on both the Democrats and Republicans, and everyone's feeling very good that we'll be able to get this thing done.
Well, good, because that sounds like an enormous amount of relief.
It is.
We got the wildfires in California. I don't think the rest of the country realized how devastating the wildfires were in Kansas and Oklahoma and Texas.
Well, they don't, but we do. But the other thing is on the economy, and we talked before. In fact, I was out there since this came out. We've already talked about the economy and what's happening right now. I have two documents that I'd like to have your listeners have available to them. Our website is inhofe.senate.gov, and if you'll access that, you can get two documents that you'll enjoy reading. One is the we're up now, let me read this and see. Yeah, we're up to 124 corporations doing business in Oklahoma that are all doing things for their employees. I was on American Airlines the other day, and the flight attendant showed me a $1,000 check that she had, and every employee of American Airlines, because of the changes that are in this in the tax reform bill, had that benefit. And the same thing is true with Walmart, all their employees and all that. Anyway, if anyone wants that list, they can access that. And the other thing is the regulations that are responsible for a lot of the great economic changes in this country that started a year ago doing away with the overregulation. I have that current count on that right now. We're up to 71 of those, and they can access that by coming to our website. Then there'll be the smartest guy on the block, and they can show people that good things are happening.
Again, give us that website again.
Yeah, inhofe.senate.gov.
Well, that's easy.
It's easy. Sure.
Okay. Senator, we know you've got a busy morning, and things are moving and shaking in the nation's capital. We know you'll take care of us, and thank you for being the wonderful senator you have been over the years.
Well, I'll keep you informed on this wildlife bill, though, so you can be the first to announce it, all right?
Please do that. Thank you very much, sir.
You bet.